gentlemen. How are you? Oh, come on out, Harry Potter fans. Where are you out there? Very nice. Well, I hope everyone is enjoying the celebration of Harry Potter 2017. Who's here for the first time at this celebration event? And how many people have been here before? Make some noise out there. Now this weekend is all about the excitement and the joy that J.K. Rowling's Wizarding World brings to our lives. Many of you traveled to be here today or journeyed to other Harry Potter experiences all over the world. Harry Potter the Exhibition brings the magic to fans by traveling from city to city. Here with us today are two people who can talk intimately about the exhibition and its many props, costumes, and creatures. Join me in welcoming Pierre Bohanna and Ed Newquist to the stage. Hello, gentlemen. Hello there. So, why don't you introduce yourselves and tell everyone how it is that you're part of this exhibition.
Sure. I'm Ed Newquist. I'm one of the creators of Harry Potter, the Exhibition, and began work on this, gosh, over 10 years ago, and it's worked with an incredible crew at the GPS and obviously Warner Brothers and the team at Beeston. So it's just been a labor of love, and we've taken it all over the world to fans who really enjoy it.
My name is
Pierre. I have the wonderful privilege and task of running the project department for all the Harry Potter films.
Very nice. Now, Eddie, can you tell us a little bit about the exhibition itself?
Sure. Well, for those of you who don't know about it, it really allows you to experience a day at Hogwarts. You arrive, you get the whole introduction, you see the train, and then we take you through the different classrooms. And along the way, you're seeing costumes and amazing props. So it really is a magical experience. It's gone to 15 cities in 9 countries.
Okay.
And we've welcomed millions of fans. We've had over 4 million people attend the exhibition over the course of the tour. So we're really proud of that.
Awesome, awesome. Well, we've got a good clip for you right now. Take a look and let's watch a few of our favorite stars tell us about the exhibition as well. Check it out.
So it's a sort of plucked from that one item that comes. expresses something better than the rest. That's not what we're about. We love that prompt.
Very nice. Now, of course, as you said, you had a team that went out and worked, you know, on these prompts. Did you ever, you know, give your team a design of something that was imagined, and then you came back and you're like, "Whoa, this is totally different than what I thought it was going to be when we first kind of conceptually started, you know, working on it."
I think props to that. And I think the process of anything, you making anything, the transition from sort of the cigarette box kind of sketch to a formal concept to a formal drawing to initial prototype to the final result, it's a very long process, and it's a very refined process. And you know, every single piece we make went through that. You know, but certainly by the nature of how Stuart Craig works, it's not like you make it first time.
Sure.
A lot of people have to be happy. And it's all about telling the story, which our little, what we're doing is our little contribution to empowering the conviction of the story that we're collaboratively making.
Any props for you stick out, or any favorites that you have?
I would say, and you know, we had a chance to look at so much of what you did, which was amazing. I would say the wands were always really interesting to me. I think because they seem to always be attached to the character in some way, shape, or form, whether that was by design or not. And we've got over 20 of the wands, you know, in the exhibition, the original wands from Harry's to Ron's and Hermione's. So when I visited the set the first time back in 2007, to speak with the different departments, I mean, we knew that fans loved the wands. We knew that that was something that they were excited to relate to.
Yeah, wands were an incredibly important responsibility and task really for the films, for all of them. Because they are absolutely bespoke to each character, every other prop is more general, but it's important. So the process that I described earlier, you have to go through, and it's considering a reflection of what that character one will be. And then the practical sense of all that, you have to produce slight versions, and it was a standard set of six, and we go from there. But
some of the ones for the stones were proper, right? Because they had to.
That's right, yeah. I mean, they're actually a wooden stick like that. It's actually, in the filming sense, it's actually quite dangerous to form with it. So you have to. And also, the wood bends and gets affected by humidity, like I think. So to keep consistency, visual consistency, at the end of the day, you just want to see one.
But there's an audio version of the actual tour. Pierre, you talk about Dumbledore's wand and creating it. You always wanted to be iconic. Would you ever think it would become something as iconic as a Deathly Hallow?
Well, no. The strategy about Dumbledore's wand, when at the time we made it, no one realised what it was going to be because that storyline hadn't actually revealed exactly the time he got his wand. So, you know, it's strange because his wand was, we didn't do it for everybody, but often we would select, we'd make a selection of wands, and it would be picked out for that, be it by the actor or by the director or producer. And that's only what happened here, we read about six different times. And that one always stood out from that selection. It was very characterful, and from any of the other ones. So it's strange how it manifested itself to be.
So if here's a question for you. So if you had 100 wands laying on the table, you know, I think, and we did, we looked at so many, I think you'd go straight to Dumbledore's. It was just so specific to him. It really rang true. And working as the Elder Wand, I mean, it's an amazing choice. It was really amazing.
Yeah, it's strange how creating variation, that much variation from something with such great focus. Yeah, you're right, it does. It brings some others.
Well, thinking about specific wands, so let's test the theory with the crowd and see if you guys can pick some out as well. So on the screen, you'll see three wands. If you think that Dumbledore's wand is A, then let's hear you cheer right now. I think it's A. All right.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, it is pretty good. If you think it's B, then let's hear you out there. If you think it's B, or these microphones aren't working, one or the other. Okay, what if you think it's C? C. Okay. So we're good. So 1A is Neville Longbottom's wand, and 1B is Fred Weasley's wand. So definitely some different characteristics there in these wands.
I was going to mention also, you know, James and Oliver Phelps, who you had a chance to work with ever since they were very young, they've been great friends of the exhibition. They've come with us to so many openings and supported us. They've become really good friends. And, you know, I know that we've always wondered why Fred's wand seemed to be in the shape of a pine cone. And I asked James once, like, why is this a pine cone? he said, I have no idea. So I don't know if you have any idea, Pierre. Was it something that just came about?
I think you should pop to the name of the parking special. I can't actually give you the source of that. It just came to him. It clicked into his characteristic. You know, the idea that they had this kind of concept of the cone and this almost like this way of hand computer was kind of standing on the back. But that's cool.
There you go, a little inside information for you guys.
Well, and speaking of Fred and George, so one of my favorite scenes is from the fourth film where they try to sneak over the age limit for the Goblet of Fire. You guys probably remember that. And so when they heard we were doing this, we managed to get the goblet in the exhibition. So, you know, it's truly a stunning piece, and that's, you know, and again, I know that when you're reading, you know it's going to be iconic, but what was the story behind creating that? Because it's really epic when you see it up close in the exhibition.
It is basically a question before, but if anything, it's one of my favorite things to do.
Okay.
Well, thank you. But at the end of Prisoner of Azkaban, obviously, we had a little break before we started Goblet of Fire. And of course, the thing I was sort of chewing over my mind while we were waiting to start was just kind of, what are the stewards going to be thinking about?
Because it's in the title.
It's all in paper cut. And so, it comes to the last one, because gilded span, maybe like in the bucket, like a wonderful full shell. We just go off on a sort of riff, but it's got to have this sort of this timeless quality, this strange magical object. What I wasn't expecting was what happened when I got to, you know, got the first drawing received, we got to the final, and we just get to roll and to the latter panel and just roll up, hit the floor and roll up. Right, I wasn't expecting that. Yeah. The 6 foot high, solid wood, and goblet. So we started, obviously talking to Stuart, and we started, went off to work, and we got a big trunk of rosewood. And Stuart looked at me and he said, no, I think I'd bring up a piece of English elm. So I kind of trawled the south of England, because elm's quite difficult to get hold of. And I saw it in a whole trunk, you know, big trees and like oaks. And I found a dealer who had 7, and he picked one of those, took it back, myself and Spike. I said, you see him there, and I picked up the river. I can't see him.
Yeah.
You see him holding up there, and he's obviously, that's the middle of winter, he's just been working so hard that he wears out like that. And the two of us just dived into it. Started working it out. And it was from a solid single trunk of elm. and it's just a wonderful process, because as you carve into it, it starts changing colour, it starts distorting and changing. It kind of is following what you're doing. And it was just such as a prop maker, it was just such a wonderful experience to sort of create something. It
took
about 3 weeks.
So iconic. You can't imagine it looking like anything else.
Yeah, that's true. Especially when you kind of see the behind the scenes look. And, I mean,
that's
enjoyed the fourth film immensely. But of course, you know, there's the game of Quidditch that was really, really missed. And the game is such an incredible part of the films, and the fans all feel such a connection to it. So, Peter, can I ask you, how difficult was it to create the brooms and the quaffles for the game?
But the brooms were a massive task for us, and they're actually a very complicated task, because they, although they're essentially an object of dust in the corner of a room, you know, they had to fly on these ones. So they all had to have proportion to keep the aesthetic quality of what we wanted to do. The metalwork, we had to look at very highly technical castings, you know, looking for aircraft grade castings, titaniums, heat treated aluminium, etc., etc., as part of speculated steel. So that we can keep it as thin and as fine as possible, and also the kind of chassis that's inside the broom itself. So you could have, you know, as the guys got older, they got bigger, so they kind of grew within, and, you know, 17 stone on the end of a big pole thrown around, that's a lot better than the back, isn't it? So it was a great tent, which wasn't the second tent, and it's one of the most pleasing things to get. There's a coffin ball started, again, it started off with the little scallops on the side, which if you've ever operated a coffin ball, they're really useful for grabbing hold of, but originally they had two balls. It was like it had come from a square shape being honed down, and it couldn't catch them. So we took one out, we ended up with that shape, and it's a much easier shape to grab.
And it's funny because we had a similar experience in the exhibition. We used the original molds to create the quaffle balls in the exhibition, and I took some of those and I brought them home to my kids. I have four kids, my daughter Ashley's here, and we had to go out and play basketball with it to try to break them, and they broke them all right away. We couldn't figure out how you guys kept it feeling leather. It took us about a dozen times to prototype it to get the right mixture, and it was still out of the original mold. So you know, we're going to pass them around right now. You guys have some
lights.
Yeah. So that you can feel, they feel amazing, they feel leather, but it took us a long time. It was pretty tricky for us to do. And now they lasted for years, but it's not easy.
Yeah, definitely. Those are really cool. So if you've got one in the audience here, yeah, you see it passing around, so everyone has a chance to experience what a cobble actually feels like and the texture there and the manageability of it.
Yeah, and I'll mention one of the things, Scotty, and that is that you can actually see the Hogwarts emblem from the original mold in what feels like the leather from the bottle. I think my kids had fun playing with it, so that was good. Well, so were there any cast members who were way into it? Was it, you know, did anybody take to it more than others from a coffin standpoint?
Yeah, that's kind of disaster. I mean, they all had a go, and it's fun. I mean, you know, James and Oliver, and then Van Inter Schools, and then people listening models. That was a good story about them. They're both mad football fans.
Big soccer fans.
But they both come, they both call rival teams from the hometown. Birmingham, where they come from. There's two first team, one Birmingham City, one's Aston Villa. And one year, while they were on set, the two teams were playing, and they basically had a bet to themselves that basically the loser had to wear the winning team shirt for a whole week.
Sure, that was entertaining. So James and Oliver, who said they actually recorded a few of the stories of their own from the exhibition. I think we're going to play those right now. You guys want to see me with James and Oliver? All right, check it out.
Gryffindor, I've got it. you'll see in the exhibition is the parchment signed by Dumbledore's army. And this was signed by Fred, George, Harry, Ron, Hermione, and all the other actors and characters who are going to be in Dumbledore's army in the fifth movie. Now, what people don't sometimes know is that the actual actors, us and ourselves, really signed our characters in this parchment. So what you see is our actual handwriting. And then, for handwriting, we're going to all the bits of important paper, especially on Fred and George involved, giving Harry the role of Latin in the third area. Now, this paper pivotal role well for a whole series of Harry Potter, and you can see the role of Latin in this theatre, and you can see exactly how Lena designed so intricately when there's stuff going all over the place. It's amazing. And then from there, we go forward to the fourth movie, featuring the Trials and Tournament. And what happened there was a magical golden egg.
A dragon.
A
Gary Horntail dragon.
Yes. It's great. So you see, this golden egg is what Harry had to get in Trials and Tournament to fight in the task, as you guys don't know. Now you see here, this magical golden egg is hidden behind a case so people wouldn't take it around with them. We tried. Sorry about that. Yes. But like I said, there's the Hungarian Horntail Dragon. Now, one of the schools that in the movie a lot of school done in CGI, a huge, huge creature. But to do so, they decided to create in the art department on a whole other scale. So here you get to see about a quarter of it. This thing's enormous. I always like to think it would be great if you had it at home. So when people come forward calling, you could just have this dragon pop out.
So here we have the title trophy on display, which you can see here, it's broad. And next to that, or around the same area in the exhibition, is the entry goblet of fire, which Fred and George had successfully put their names in the window, spat out, tell you what the name, and then it flies.
Well, we can kind of injure the director in filming that scene. But that's a conversation for another day. But talking about costumes and stuff, we then go forward to costumes that Jenny made for Harry Potter's great cast friends.
The greatest
characters. Yeah, Fred and George, as you guys know, very, very good. So Jenny decided that they should have their individual tweaks, but they're very good at their own self-marketing. So they decided to give themselves slightly different costumes to each other in the fact that they were similar. Different colours, different sweaters, different waistcoats, just little things to differentiate with them. So you can see that there and then.
And especially the costumes in the final area of the exhibition, which actually the final costume is what Fred and George wore in the eighth movie when the Battle of Hogwarts scene is all about. And especially the Lockheed movie when we first start filming, which is very, very good. Next to that, you will see Fred and George, Harry, Ron, Hermione's, all the other guys, once. And you'll see how Pierre designed all these ones so different that each character one is unique to that character. George's character was shaped almost like a roof, whereas Fred's was a bit different.
Oh, pine cone. I don't get this, so I understand that, you know, George was really great flying these, but I don't know what pine cone was for. Maybe he enjoyed pine cones or something. Yeah, maybe you can fit us out in this one. And we've saved one of our favourite areas for last. Now, as some of you may know, Oliver and I are big sports fans. And of course, in the Wizarding World, you have Quidditch. And Quidditch is a great thing because you get to see the costumes, the evolution of the costumes as well, and all the different balls used to play the game Quidditch.
And also, you lucky people get to experience me this weekend, Quidditch tossing with Frank Hoffman. And it's pretty much the exact similar experience to the exhibition where all the props, all the ball, hood, are the authentic size, weight, and shape, and they were used when they filmed.
Well, we've asked our friends at the exhibition for a bit of a favour. So what we've done, we've got a quaffle, and what we've done is we've signed it. And we're going to give it away to you guys as a bit of a prize.
The best thing is, one of you guys will win.
So, thank you again for listening to us. Not really had a choice. But we hope you enjoyed some of our little memories of Harry Potter's 8 movies that we're on.
And enjoy the rest of your weekend celebrating Harry Potter 2017. Hey, go along!
Well, there it is.
his pointed arm was really far. So I didn't realize that the at the exhibition, when touring around, we got a Quidditch pop-up shop, which is really nice.
Well, and I think what we'd like to do is, since we have a bottle here, I think we'd like Pierre to sign it. Is that alright with you, Pierre? All right.
After all,
the stories are signed by the twins as well, so.
And since we're putting some signatures on there.
Well, we'll put this in the exhibition maybe, back at
Well, I mean, that'd be cool and all, but maybe, I don't know, would one of you guys like to win? I need the most enthusiastic Harry Potter fan out there. Really? Okay. Right here with the line. Oh, yes. Come on down here. There you go. Now, it's not going to be easy. Were you at the celebration last night when we opened the whole thing up? So you were there. Okay, so you might have mentioned that. Well, actually, I don't want to yell at you and have you yelling. I'm going to come down here. So just pick right there for me.
Right now, I don't know. Maybe we should put it back in the exhibition.
We should give it away. We'll test her to test her knowledge here if we could. So just Steve, would you come help me for a second? I gotta go this. Here, just come on, yeah. You just go ahead and stand right there if you don't mind. I'm just gonna crawl over this. Yeah, just got it. I'm good. Just make up your leg. Okay.
Scott.
Wait. Hold on, wait! Hold on. Oh my god. Thank you, Steven. Steven, ladies and gentlemen.
Steven, I'll go.
Thank you. Why? Oh no, thanks so much. Why are we? So good. Oh, the Quaffle, right? Hi! How are you? What's your name? Anathea. Everybody say, hey, Anathea! Anathea, where are you from? You're from Texas. Anyone else here from Texas? Anyone else right front? Your peeps are right here. Hello. Okay, you're like giving yourself away there. You're like, woo, here we go. Okay, so I've got a question for you. It's a two-part question, but I'm going to let you answer both parts right now, okay? So the tour, as we mentioned last night, has visited many places. Okay, there were specific numbers that Eddie mentioned when he first started his speech. So, first of all, how many countries has the tour been through? How many countries? Do you know the answer? What do you think it is?
Nine.
Okay, that's right, so far. Nine is good. How many, I know, take it easy. Not on this one though, it's a little hard to manage. How many stops in those nine countries? Do you know? Go for it.
15.
That is correct, ladies and gentlemen. You have won yourself a signed problem. Come on over here, let's give a big round of applause. Andy, that was fun.
I thought you were going to break something, Scott.
Well, I was hoping I would, because then we'd have to put something else in the exhibition. Yeah, come on down here with me. Just watch your step as you come around there. Ladies and gentlemen, did you enjoy yourselves? Very nice there. Let's give a big round of applause to Pierre and Eddie, and thank you all for coming out and enjoy the rest of your weekend at the celebration of Harry Potter 2017.